I think it's time. So, yes. Well, the rest might, Carolina will let them in. All right. So, well, good afternoon. I'm going to be your host today. My name is Angelica Nostrosa. And on behalf of Universidad Andrés Bello, Campus Viña del Mar, I welcome you to this webinar named Test Running Mediating Changes in a Teacher Education. This webinar is going to be presented by Dr. Danisa Salinas. She holds a PhD degree in education, a master's degree in linguistics, and 2 teaching degrees. Yes. She's currently a professor at Universidad Andrés Bello in the Faculty of Education in Viña del Mar. And her fields of study are teacher identity, applied linguistics, and teacher formation. She has been forming teachers of English for more than 12 years and has participated in national and international conferences and has published several papers in her field of study, both in English and Spanish. So I could continue letting you know all her curriculum, but I think that with that, you get an idea of the relevance that this webinar will have. Yes, so I'll leave you with Dr. Salinas. The questions are going to be written in the chat, please, and then I will ask the questions for you to Professor Salinas. Okay, so you can write your questions in the chat. So leading that conversation. So Danisa, you may.
Thank you for your welcoming presentation. Thank you very much,
Angie. You deserve that and more.
Okie dokie. So I'm going to show it. Can you see the slide? Yes?
Yes.
Okay, lovely. So I want to share with you this research that we did with Paula. I was in charge of the research, but she helped me building it up. Paula Charbonnet, she's also a teacher at UNAB. Well, this research I'm going to share with you was done in Viña del Mar in the pedagogy program, the English pedagogy program, with students in the course of applied linguistics. And it was done last year at the beginning of the pandemic, right, in the first semester of 2020. Okay, for you to have an idea where it started. And so we all know that this movement to the online learning made us rethink our courses, the design of our courses, especially in assessment. At the beginning, I started the class with face-to-face classes in applied linguistics because we started in March, on the 2nd of March last year. So we had 2 weeks face-to-face classes, and then suddenly we went online. So we were really tense, not only me as a teacher, but students as well. So I had to rethink the design and especially assessment. And you say, why? Well, there are some reasons. First of all, you know, dishonesty and security issues regarding assessments, especially when giving tests. And also, I also had thought of this course before the pandemic, because it was a face-to-face course, right? And I had thought before, you know, that sometimes we pay much attention to information more than rather the process of the teaching and learning practices. And then at the same time, you know, there is a kind of pressure on education stakeholders in the process as critical to promoting 21st century skills in the students. And not only at university or higher education level, but at all level worldwide. The idea is to promote these 21st century skills on our students. So the background of this action research, Here we go. I'll show you the questions afterwards. The background, you know, when I designed this course previous to the pandemic, I thought there was a kind of disconnection between this transformative pedagogy that we wanted to implement or apply in our program with the learning results. And sometimes it happened, that is back in the past, that at the end of the program, the pre-service teachers had kind of forgotten all the theory or the things we had seen in applied linguistics, and they were not able to apply them in their practicums and even in their thesis research. So then we went into this sudden online setting. I had to rethink the instructional design, especially assessment practices, right? And I also had to look for ways to involve students in assessment and also try to develop kind of agency, right? Agency for them to be able to participate in the classes. So from that perspective then, I applied this new learning model, installing a project-based summative evaluation process, yeah? And I took a Black and Williams assessment model for learning. And what I tried to use was develop this agency, focusing on the 21st century skills. Now, let's continue with the questions. So having this in mind in this applied linguistics course, I raised these three questions in the research. What was the nature of the learning and assessment experiences of this group of pre-service teachers in the online setting they had to transition to as a result of the pandemic? The other question is, in what ways could we encourage increased agency or control of their learning and assessment process? And what impact, if any, would these changes in practices have in their engagement in deep learning? Are you listening?
Yes,
yes, you loud and clear.
Yes, how? Thank you. So, having these questions, the conceptual background of the research is the ecological theory of learning. Okay, this ecological paradigm takes a lot of emphasis on the relationship and contextual understanding, which focuses on the complex process of interaction between the teacher and the students, which is sometimes complex. And also this ecological theory sees the assessment and feedback as a from that perspective into this socio-ecological learning system. So here we have first ecological theory and agency as the main concept. Here I'm going to show you some different views of the definitions that some theorists have on agency. First of all, it is crucial in higher education as it challenges the pedagogical practices. At the same time, it involves more metacognitively awareness and encourage students to take an active role in the process of their learning. At the same time, agency is stated as a core of an assessment for learning approach. So taking these three views, we can say that within this approach, promoting metacognitive awareness, engagement, and control means implicating students in the decision-making, material generating, evaluating, and providing feedback. Okay, so this is more, these are the most important concepts within the agency seen from different perspectives. Regarding the methodological design, this is a project, an action research project with three phases. Regarding the context, it was done in a private, as I said, a private university in Chile. The participants were 21 Chilean pre-service teachers. between 20 and 29 years old. They were in this applied linguistics class. Two of them were repeating the course. One individual student had special needs within both motor and visual challenges. The important thing is that 29% of these students had attended public or subsidized schools before entering the university. Now, the analysis, the perspective that, or the paradigm that I used was qualitative, where we have all the data sets, then we get the coding right in order to get the main categories to finally reach the conceptual framework. Now, regarding tools to collect data, first of all, we had these reflective journals from the pre-service teachers during all the semester from March to June. They had every 15 days, they had to write these reflective journals regarding their experiences as students in this research project. And also the teacher educator reflective journal, that is, I also wrote a journal with all my perceptions, views, feelings, etc. And also we had these observations and field notes, you know, that through Blackboard we could record all the classes. So there I could see, you know, have the direct observations. And at the end of the course, I had some interviews with individual students and with groups of students. So we had four data collection tools. Now I'm going to explain the action research, the three phases of this action research. The first phase was from in March and April, the second May and June, and finally in June and July, I collected more data. But in March, I started with face-to-face classes for 2 weeks, as I said. Then suddenly we went online, okay? So I had to redesign the class, but mainly it had been a thought to have the first half of the class with a traditional teaching approach and of course traditional assessment approach. So what I did was the typical thing, students, the topics were the pioneers, right? Pioneers of applied linguistics, pioneers in second language acquisition theories and hypotheses. And they had to first have these presentations, which were evaluated, of course, pioneers and theories. And then they also had to write essays on the topics. And they had a test, a typical test on these theories on second language acquisition and English as a foreign language. That was the first part. Then the second phase, I started with the project-based assessment process. I had to explain to them in detail what a project-based learning is about, although they had seen it before in methodology, but anyway, it had to be clear, and how these 21st century skills had to be developed within this project, all right? So there was a completely different modality now. They formed groups, and they chose the most convenient, the topic in the theories that they had seen in second language acquisition and English as a foreign language. So they took the topics that were more interesting for them, and they had to make up this project based on that. But we had classes, I had individual meetings with them, with each group, trying to guide their project, giving them ideas, and you know, seeing how they were doing in order to develop their agency. So I met at the same time of the classes, I met with them weekly. And well, of course, in the project based, you all know they had to come up with this driving question. There should be reflection, a lot of inquiry. They had to find out and read about the state of art. So it was really complete. And they liked this idea of having, they had to choose the project, the topic, and they had to choose what they were going to do within this frame. Okay, and that lasted, that was in May and June. Then the last phase, I collected, I had this personal individual interviews and group interviews with the students regarding their perceptions with the, what they had gone through. Okay, so what did we get? There was this, I had this dynamic shift in these spaces. You know, first it was a face-to-face. We had a class face-to-face. Then we went into this online, but at the beginning with this kind of traditional approach. Then we went into this project-based approach. That was the main thing here. But I wanted them to see the difference, to give their opinions about the difference. So it was within this, the interaction of the teacher-educator and groups of pre-service teachers and their interaction with the social media tools that they exploited that gave rise to a dynamic shift on these spaces. And there were two main themes uncovered. The first one was that the increasing 21st century competencies, that was really good. And the other finding was that there are still some bridges to cross, okay? There are some drawbacks that we still have to see about it, yeah? Now, for you to remember, try to remember what are these 21st century skills. These are known worldwide and they are being applied in all educational settings at higher education, schools, etc. And they are divided in three categories. The first one is learning and innovation skills, which include critical thinking, creativity, metacognitive awareness, and self-directedness. In the life and career skills, they are teamwork, leadership, and collaboration. And in the digital literacy skills, we have openness to ICT skills for learning and understanding the value of promoting the use of ICT. So these are the famous 21st century skills that we all try to promote and develop in our students. Now, I hope that you can all see and I hope that you can all read the excerpts or the quotations from the students. Here I'm going to show you the evidence for each of the skills and how they, as you can see through the excerpts and through their opinions, how they developed these skills: critical thinking, creativity, metacognitive awareness, and self-directedness. What I want you to do, if you could please read the quotations in silence, and then I'm going to give the interpretation, please. Are you all ready? As future teachers. Okay, this is one of the excerpts taken from the students regarding critical thinking. As you can see, this pre-service teacher is questioning the legitimacy of current government-sponsored methodologies, right? Now, regarding creativity, please read the excerpt. So, regarding creativity, you can see that the power they assumed to be heard and to choose in the assessment for learning project, this pre-service teacher sees the opportunity for exercising imagination and freedom to think creatively. Let's see regarding metacognitive awareness. Please read the student's quotation. In this case, this pre-service teacher shows an awareness of the cognitive steps which are needed to be taken for effective problem solving. Mm-hmm. And now please read the self-directedness. See that they even talk about the project when they met for other reasons. They finally finished talking about the project. So here, seeking opportunities to connect and discuss solutions and project plans That is to say, to learn outside the formal designating time set aside for doing so are indicative of self-direction. You know, because they had to get together in order to continue to develop their project. They met with me only once a week for 20 minutes, each group, where they showed me what they had done, and then I guided them. Okay, let's see the other set of 21st century skills regarding life and career skills. They are teamwork, leadership, and collaboration. Let's see the evidence, how they developed this. Please, you read in silence again the excerpt. This is important, but with this work, we had to organize our time. That was important. So, science of an emerging understanding of effective practices in working as groups. Regarding leadership, please read in silence. This student, I think they were in charge of a block. They wanted their project was that their students had to have a block for speaking skills. So showing the awareness of the leadership qualities necessary as teachers to encourage engagement and learning in virtual settings such as blocks. And look at collaboration, please. The pre-service teacher said, because we did all the work together, we knew how to distribute the parts according to our abilities. So working together in groups showed increased capacity to make the most of individual strengths and abilities needed for successful collaboration. And finally, the last set of 21st century skills regarding digital literacy skills, and they are openness to ICT skills for learning and understanding the value of promoting the use of ICT. Here, the pre-service teacher said, as future teachers, we always have to innovate because technology and students are changing. Definitely, so you can see the openness to ICT skills for learning. And then the other student regarding understanding the value of promoting the use of ICT said, in addition, using a block to learn promotes autonomous learning by providing opportunities for students to have more control over their learning. Also, using block motivates students to become better readers and writers, which are very important skills when people are learning English. See, one group chose this assessment project to design a block to help students they had in their practicums develop digital and linguistic literacy skills. See, so what can we conclude? The other finding, these were the findings regarding the 21st century skills in this project. Now, the other finding were the drawbacks. What are the some of the less favorable findings during this second period? Well, there was some resistance showing up for the individual group meetings. In fact, some students missed these individual meetings, okay? They came just sometimes to these meetings. Sometimes only one member of the group showed up. All right. Other groups were perfect. They were there at the time and they all participated and they had done all their tasks, that the ones that they had promised. So that was one of the drawback, resistance showing up for the individual group meetings. And of course, as a result, some of these projects were kind of weak, I would say, and they lacked originality, creativity. They could have been done better. But we have to remember that regarding agency, this resides in the affordances that assessment offers for agentic learning. So they are not born with this agency skill. They have to develop it, and we have to help them develop it. And my mistake was that I think I overlooked the importance of offering opportunities for peer feedback. I think that they present in the process when they had to report all their work, I just worked with them as a group, and there wasn't feedback from the other groups. Maybe that was missing. I should have looked for another way of seeing to that. And the other thing is that maybe I should have showed the rubrics of the project at the beginning and made them give some opinions about that, so that they feel that they also were involved. So what can we get as a conclusion? As a conclusion, we all know that because of this pandemic, although there were lots of challenges worldwide, definitely we saw the need for new assessment practices, definitely, not the typical test or the essay, etc. And also, we can kind of open this secret garden of assessment and try to mediate with students and teachers, have more agentic roles, and maybe try to involve students in these rubrics or in this evaluation and assessment. Now, we all know, we all lived this pandemic, and we all know that we had feelings, kind of negative feelings of distress, uncertainty, fear, stress. However, what they wrote in some of their reflective journals was that sometimes they felt pride, confidence, and compliment and empowerment, especially when they finished this project that at the beginning thought it was really difficult to accomplish in such a short time. And finally, these modest instructional change, you know, can or do lead to deep systematic changes. That's it. Thank you. That's my name, my email, in case you want to write.
Thank you, Thank you very much, Danisa. Excellent presentation, very interesting. And well, congratulations on this, because as you say, this is something that you have to do little by little.
Yes.
Not this change, this shift that we have need to have time to develop.
Yes, thank you.
Well, I invite everybody to ask questions. You can write them on the chat. I don't have any questions up to now, but I'm sure that they were so absorbed by what you were telling us. That's why they haven't asked any questions yet. So think about questions.
Yes, you are. I am open to answer any question, details, whatever you want to ask about. Go ahead.
You know that I would like to start.
Lovely.
I know that you have based this on students, but what could you say about these students that were that their projects were weaker? How did you cope with that?
Yeah, you know that first of all, I had these rubrics where one of the points was their participation. Yeah, so of course they got a lower mark because of that, and because of the quality of the design at the end of the project that was not as good as others. So they were kind of punished with mark, but I feel that some students definitely don't have, maybe, I don't know if it is the willingness to develop this agency. Some of the students need to, you know, they respond just because of a mark, but the idea is that they respond from inside out, see, not from outside in. Yeah, that's, and it was difficult, although there wasn't a group that never showed up. Yes, they showed up, that sometimes only one student, sometimes two out of four. Yes,
and I imagine that when they actually saw the classmates, you know, performing and feeling proud and confident, this is something that maybe for the next time, next course, maybe they are going to participate more.
You know, when they presented their projects at the end, some of them were awesome, really, because some students had even done some these surveys and got 60, 70 answers from students in the country because they did it online. And sometimes even in the thesis that we planned, they don't get that amount of data collection. Yes, some of them were awesome.
I see. All right. I don't know if anybody has another question for Ms. Danisa. I think that you presented this so accurately, Danisa, that maybe that's why the audience doesn't have any questions. Yes. We'll give them some seconds. Let's see.
Yeah, there's a question. In your opinion, what takes a teacher of English to be to develop agency? I think that we as teacher educators should promote this from the very beginning, from the time they are in the program, try to have activities so they can develop this agency so they could get involved in it, and they could say, you know, I can do that. Oh, you know, that was my the results from my hard work. I think that from the very beginning we have to try to develop this skill, although there are some students who have them naturally. But this agency, this sense of responsibility, the sense of achievement, the sense of being creative, we have to develop that creativity. Giving feedback, they have to learn to give feedback to themselves, to criticize themselves, themselves as well as others, you know, from a positive perspective. That's what I think.
Yes, wonderful. Thank you. Another thing that I think it's really relevant that you can go deeper into is this about getting students involved in the assessment.
Yes.
Like,
yes,
creating their own rubric, maybe. Well, what are your ideas there?
Yes, I missed that, and I think it's a very good idea to present the rubrics that you have prepared for the class, and then, you know, what do you think about it? And sometimes they give you very good ideas, because with another class, I did it. Since I hadn't done it with this class, the second semester with another class, I did it. It was really useful, and they got involved, you know, and they really worked on that. It was nice.
Yes, fantastic. Well, Professor Danisa Salinas, thank you very much for your presentation. And I would like to leave you with the invitation.
There are two other questions.
Oh, thank you.
Antonia.
Well, it just appeared. I'm going to read it. Does self-awareness...
Is self-awareness involved?
Is self-awareness involved in this process? And how can we promote it?
Ooh, difficult. Self-awareness. I think that I feel that with the students is important to teach them how to see yourself, to reflect. First of all, with reflection, because when you make them reflect, and you can make them reflect different ways, for example, by writing short narratives, or by talking to you, by talking among between classmates. So when they start reflecting, and then they start realizing that they have like good things and bad things in relation to from the academic point of view, of course. So if they see that, then they are going to start being aware of their maybe strengths and weaknesses. All right. And I think that could be one starting point with the students, to have that self-awareness. Mm-hmm. Thank you for the question, Antonia.
Yes, we have another question. Do you think students understand the real concept of assessment, or are they just focused on rewards?
I think they are not. Even I think that they don't even see the difference between assessment and evaluation for them, you know, grading. I think that they don't understand the concept. And I think it is also our task as teacher educators to promote that from the very beginning, what assessment is, right? And the difference with evaluation. And we should promote that and make them clear and make the concept clear for them. Yes, I think they don't know it because they come from high school, you know, and they're the typical thing that there's so much grading in high school. And I think in some, not in all of them, but in some, schools, they don't have this, they have not tried to develop these 21st century skills that worldwide they are trying to develop.
Mm-hmm. That's right. Yes, thank you. We have to take that into consideration. Yes, the difference between evaluation, assessment, scoring, yes, and everything. I think that students sometimes don't pay much attention to that. They think it's just content. So we,
right,
what you are doing is great, because then we can have, you know, this self-awareness also involved.
Right.
Yes.
Yes.
So,
yes.
Fantastic.
And I think that feedback, is teaching them how to give feedback to their students is also good, because they have a more critical point. But that feedback must always be given with arguments, not only because I liked it or because I didn't like it, but why you think that? Yes. And that is something that we have to kind of enhance that with our students, so then they replicate that with their students. That's the only way, because, you know, we teach these future teachers, but then they might give, you know, the same, I mean, they replicate this to so many students. So I think we have a really strong responsibility there.
Indeed, indeed. All right. Here we have, I don't know if it's Antonio or Antonia Zuniga, saying that's really important to give meaningful feedback.
Yes. Yes, Antonia, I completely agree. Because we tend to students at the beginning, whenever I ask them at the beginning to give feedback, there is generally kind of, yes, that everything is perfect. Oh, great. Even I ask peer evaluation. I ask for peer evaluation and they always give them sevens and that's it, you know, but they are not really critical. They don't use their critical thinking. They think that they are going to harm the student. The classmate is going to feel bad about it, but they have to learn to receive, you know, some negative things, right? And right. I think there is another question.
Yes, we have another one. It says, do students come prepared to develop agency when they enter our pedagogy program? What a question.
To be honest, I don't think so. I don't think so. You know that so many changes have been done in the educational reforms nationally. But what I feel is that everything stays there written. I don't know what happens, that just some teachers, you know, they try to develop more creativity, agency, self-awareness, etc. But in general, all these changes stay in paper. They are not reproduced in the schools, and I feel so bad, because I know that there is an effort from the Minister of Education to try to develop, to change from the very beginning, but it's difficult. I think that in preschool, they really develop many things. I think that that's the best part of our education, I would say, the preschool. They really develop things with the students. But then when they come into the elementary school and high school, we kind of put it too academically. We are too academic in teaching, you know. So I think they are not prepared, but I wish that we could put some a sand grain there to help develop this with our students at the university.
Yes, so we have lots of things to do. Yes. Here I have another. Yvette says, it's interesting to see how students don't focus on the weak points of their peers to give recommendations. Yes, as they just highlight the positive aspects.
Yes, yes.
This is what you were saying about.
You are right, Yvette. I think it's a cultural point, it's a cultural issue. We don't want to judge the other person. But in other cultures, you know, they give this feedback and they are still friends, you know. It's something that we have to develop from the very beginning, to be honest but respectful. You can say things respectfully in a nice way, and I think we should have to learn that. We have to change that culture, I would say, Yvette. Absolutely.
All right, let's see if we have any other questions. I don't want to to end it, because then when I'm going to present something and a question appears. But well,
I think that's
you, yes, you told me that this was for 40 minutes more or less, so we are on.
Yes.
Just on time. Yes.
Thanks.
So we really appreciate, yes, your presentation. It was really very, very interesting and food for the thought, yes, for our minds as teacher formers, okay? And, well, I thank you, everybody, for joining this presentation today. And I'm going to leave open an invitation that's going to take place the 15th of November. Also, it's a Monday at 5:30. This is going to be about the precariousness and interculturality in the multicultural EFL classroom. This is also research done by Professor Carolina Perez Arredondo. And so you will receive the poster very soon. And I leave you with that invitation. Thank you, Ms. Danisa, again. Thank you to all the participants. Yes?
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Thank you, Angie.
Thank you, Helga. You can read them in the chat.
Thank you.